ओम श्री साईराम, आई ऑफर माई मोस्ट हम्बल एंड लविंग प्रणाम्स एट भगवान्स लोटस फीट। फ्यू वीक्स बैक अ थॉट स्ट्रक माई माइंड दैट ईच एंड एवरी मोमेंट दैट वी एक्सपीरियंस इन लाइफ इज एफिमेरल एंड देर आर मैनी डिफाइनिंग मोमेंट्स इन आवर लाइफ। एज आई वॉज पॉन्डरिंग ओवर दिस थॉट, few questions arose in my mind, that what is it that causes such a drastic impact in our life? What is the driving force behind all our actions? Is it our own effort or is it the conscious willpower which causes an action? Soon I realized that it is nothing but the creator of these thoughts, the fickle mind which wanders here and there. It is so quick to react to any situation that finally man succumbs to it and becomes its ultimate prey. What I personally feel is that there are two kinds of people on this earth. The first category of people are those whose mind keeps wandering here and there, and they become victims of their own inability to make decisions for themselves. The second category of people are those who have complete control over their mind because of a divine connection. And this connection leads them to constantly think about God and surrender each and every activity to God. At this juncture, I would like to narrate a small example, a small incident which took place in my own life. This reflects my own wandering mind. It was May 2011, a period wherein each and every outside student who is a big devotee of Swami would be eagerly waiting to join his institute and be proud to call himself as a Sai student. I was one of those outsiders who was in Prashanti Nilayam. I had applied for my BBM and BCom courses in the institute. As the formalities went, the entrance exam and the interview went on very well. The next day, I headed towards Bangalore, from where I would be boarding a bus to Mumbai. The journey in the bus would take around 18 hours. The journey started, and halfway through the journey, many thoughts were running in my mind, whether I will get a seat in Swami's hallowed institute or not. I was analyzing the various possibilities of my future. I was very worried for my uncertain future. As these thoughts were running in my mind, I just casually asked my mom as to what are my chances of getting a seat in Swami's institute. And she immediately replied that it is nothing but Swami's divine will which will eventually prevail. How much ever you try, Swami's will cannot change. As I was trying to understand what she spoke, I just closed my eyes. And I don't know what prompted me to suddenly open my eyes after 2 or 3 seconds. As soon as I opened my eyes felt on one green mango box which was situated right at the top of the baggage area. I thought, what will this green mango box try to signify to me? But one word which was inscribed on the outer part of that box had a very deep impact on me. And that was the word selection, which was an indirect indication from Bhagwan himself that he knows each and every thought that was running in my mind. That was the moment with which my conviction in Bhagwan grew slowly but surely. And that's when I started my spiritual journey in life. Life is a journey which takes us to some remote corner of the world. But one fundamental question arises in everyone's mind. The question is that, is that destination the ideal place where we want to halt, or is it just an unexpected incident?
The answer to this question lies in our understanding of life. Many people consider ourselves to be mere instruments in the divine hands, but it is ultimately up to us to follow our conscience, make an effort to have a big impact on the course of life.
At this juncture, I get reminded that there is a very big need for self-introspection. The introspection which will lead a person to know his life better. A person would start to know what genuinely makes him happy. And this is when we become true warriors of life. Any commoner would have a cubic centimeter of chance which would pop out in front of his eyes from time to time. And here lies the underlying difference between a commoner and a warrior. A commoner just admires that cubic centimeter of chance, even without using that opportunity. But on the other hand, here is this warrior who utilizes that opportunity, who is ever alert and deliberately waits. When this cubic centimeter of chance comes his way, he picks it up with both hands. This is one of the greatest hallmarks of big leaders today. They seize the moment at the right time. Carpe diem, as it is called in French. One of the greatest English poets, Robert Frost, talks about walking the unknown path in his poem, The Road Not Taken. He had two paths in front of him. One was the path which was very common and was also and was for also-rans. And the other path consisted of dense bushes and thorns. And yet, Robert Frost chooses the path to explore the unexplored destination, which is the unknown path. Sometimes I feel that having joined Swami's Institute, I have taken this unknown path of life. It would have been so easy for me to join any reputed college in Mumbai. But what forced me to come to Swami's Institute? It is merely His divine grace. And when we talk about what all we have learnt in Swami's Institute, yes, there is time management, there is discipline, there is this aspect of adjusting with new people. But the most fundamental aspect which I learnt was to inculcate this habit of contemplating within and realize my unrealized potential. And that has made me spiritually involved in my life. There are many people who say different things about God. And there comes the spiritual awareness of contemplation. Swami has always emphasized on one language, and that is the language of the heart. Many people perceive this language to be unknown, as the purity with which a person speaks is perceived to be coming from his mind. But the true speaker is the heart. Swami has also explained various concepts about consciousness, the underlying principle being that at each and every moment, a person has to realize that God resides within him. He is just a manifestation in this omnipresent world. And that's the only thing which a person needs to realize. And when he realizes this, there is this inner voice which constantly guides him and protects him at each and every moment of life. Swami has said many a times, follow the master, face the devil, fight till the end, and finish the game. And what is the underlying principle of this? When we start contemplating and introspecting on our own mind, we will understand that this true self reflects our true identity and realizes our purpose of existence. And when a person realizes this, he experiences supreme bliss or ananda. This level of happiness is way beyond any other materialistic level of happiness. A very famous short story writer, Leo Tolstoy, once said, that true happiness lies within. And the only purpose of life is happiness. So in order to seek this happiness, how can we experience the divine one-to-one connection with the Lord who is ever pervading? It is only by contemplating on the subtle aspects of life. Why has Swami told us to do silent sitting or meditation for a few minutes in a day? It is to purify our heart and cleanse our mind in such a way that all our obstacles will get cleared away. At that level of thoughtlessness, that level of purity in mind, we experience eternal bliss. As I said, we follow the Master, the underlying principles with which Bhagwan has guided each and every one of our minds is the true aspect with which we have to focus and carry out the spiritual path of life. And when this happens, He will surely give us the courage to ponder over the various obstacles of life. These obstacles are nothing but the worldly pleasures and attractions to which a person gets deviated, be it name, fame, popularity, etc. And when this happens, He also gives us the strength to fight till the end. We all know that addictions are very hard to come by, are very hard to leave by. So when is it so possible to leave these addictions? He gives us the courage and strength to overcome them and follow this constant path towards self-realization and ultimately to merge with the eternal self. We have to finish the game, which is the ocean of life, which will carry us out of all our miseries, all our past karmas, which we must have buried. With these few words, I would just like to pray to Swami to give us the strength to guide us, to protect us at each and every moment of our life and carry on the spiritual sojourn. Thank you. Jai Sairam.
Om Shri Sairam, I offer my loving pranams at the lotus feet of my dearest mother Sai. Respected elders, my dear sisters and brothers, a loving Sairam to one and all. There was once a small boy who wanted to meet God. He knew that it was a long journey to where God was, and so he packed his bag with few sandwiches and a drink and started out on his journey. After he had walked a considerable distance, he met an old lady who was sitting in a park. He took out his drink and was about to have it when he noticed that the old lady looked hungry and tired, so he offered her a sandwich. The old lady gratefully accepted it and smiled at the little child. Her smile was so delightful that the boy wanted to see it again. So after some time, he offered her a drink. And the old lady again smiled at him. This filled the boy's heart with joy. The old lady and the small boy sat in the park the whole afternoon eating and smiling. As it grew dark, the boy got up to leave, but after he had taken a few steps, he turned back, ran towards the old lady and gave her a huge hug. The old lady in return gave him her biggest ever smile, suffused with love. When the boy reached his house, his mother asked him, "What did you do that made you so happy today?" And he replied, "Mother, today I had lunch with God," and added, "You know what? She has got the most beautiful smile I have ever seen." And when the old lady reached her house, her son asked her, "Mother, what has made you so happy?" And she said, "I ate sandwiches in the park with God. And you know what? He's much younger than I ever thought." In this story, the small boy felt the hunger that the old lady had. His concern and compassion for the old lady was given to her in the form of a sandwich. The old lady was moved by the love of the small boy, and she gave her love to him in the form of a beautiful smile. The moral of this story is that both the old lady and the small boy had the wonderful experience of meeting God. The selfless love that they gave each other made each feel that the other was God. One thing which is very evident from this story is that God is a four-letter word. L-O-V-E. Love. This feeling of love is quintessentially an intense thought or feeling of oneness amongst ourselves. To cultivate this feeling of oneness, there is a three-step process. The first is to pretend, then to tend, and finally to end. The word pretend here does not mean what it is usually called as, that is, to deceive someone by acting in a way which makes you feel selfish for your selfish motives. The word pretend here means to behave in a way, to change your behavior and actions in a way to replicate the ideal you want to be. Since the ideal here is to develop the feeling of oneness, we must start thinking that there is no difference between ourselves and others. As we develop this feeling of oneness, or start pretending to feel this, we start tending to feel the joys and sorrows of all our fellow beings as our own. Finally, we reach a stage wherein we end up realizing this feeling of oneness in us. Swami often says that when a thorn pricks your foot, your hand rushes immediately to remove the thorn. In a similar way, when one section of the society faces discrimination, is troubled and tormented, it is the innate responsibility of all the others in the society to rush to their help. This feeling of empathy will come in us only when we cultivate life's most valuable emotion, love. The ongoing Gram Seva is a practical course in selfless love and its impact on its society. On one hand, it teaches the students and teachers, and on the other, it elevates the villagers with the feelings of devotion and gratitude. In a particular year, after the students had finished their service, they were returning to the vehicles. They saw a young man walking on the road and asked him if he had received prasadam. The man replied in the negative. So one student picked up a food packet and a laddu and approached the young man. Immediately, the young man retraced his steps and went back saying, "Sir, please don't come close to me. I am a Harijan, an outcast." In response to this, the student went closer, put his arm on the young man with all love and affection and said, "Harijan is a man of God. Why should I not come close to you? Our beloved Bhagwan says that all men are brothers." These words were not from a prepared speech or a rehearsed drama. They were spontaneous expressions of love from the heart of the student. When the food packet was placed in the hands of the young man, he was overwhelmed. He wiped his tears and said, "Sai Baba is God, for he alone cares for one and all without any distinction." This is yet another incident which shows us that God is a four-letter word, love. In the world today, the society is afflicted with multitudes of predicaments. Sisters and brothers, when we walk out into the society as messengers of Sai, we must hold in our hearts the selfless love that God shares with us, that Swami has given us. With this love, we must heal the wounds of hatred, anger, and greed. There must come a day when every man in distress no longer looks up into the heaven for God, but finds God amongst his own brethren, ever ready to help, to care, to love. It may happen that sometimes we are not able to express our love to all the people who are distressed, who are far away. But be rest assured, brothers, selfless love can be expressed in the form of a simple prayer, which God answers immediately. Swami taught me this lesson about the efficacy of a selfless prayer. It was in the year 2011, in the month of March. Swami had not been keeping good health. It pained me extremely to see Swami come this way for darshan. One day, in the hostel, along with two brothers, I was going through a book which contained few photographs of Swami. To add to my agony about his ill health, we came across a photograph in which Swami was laughing heartily. We then felt how long it had been that we had seen Swami like this. We then decided to pray collectively that Swami should smile. That evening, when we went for darshan, I saw that Swami was still unwell. With a prayer in my heart and a letter in my hand, I waited for him. As he came close to me, he looked straight into my eyes and all of a sudden gave me a beautiful smile. That day, I cried profusely and I realized that a selfless prayer from our hearts will be responded by God immediately, for God is love. To conclude, I would like to quote Bhagwan's own words. I quote, God is love and love is God. Wherever there is love, God is evident. Love more and more people, more and more intensely. Transform this love into service. Transform this service into worship, for this is the highest sadhana. Unquote. We tune a radio to hear a song to a particular frequency. In a similar way, we must turn the dial of our minds to the frequency of selfless love so that we can experience God. So tune yourself to love and stay tuned to God. Swami, I pray, just like the small child in the story, let each one of us cultivate this selfless love and experience your presence in our lives forever. Thank you, Sai Ram.
Empty of myself stands before thee, thy make, thy sculpture, thy grace. In readiness to receive from thee thy breath, thy command, thy will. Sighs of gratitude puffs up this eye, this vessel thee embraceth as thine. This soul as it bows ever yearns to be thine. My loving and reverential Sai greetings to all my elders, brothers and sisters. Sai says yes, and all of us nod in affirmation. Sai says no, and all of us cease to act. Sai says wait, and all of us give ourselves to indefinite waiting. And when Sai decides not to say at all, our lives decide not to live. Yes, Sai's saying is all that matters to all of us. Sai said, he says, and he will say, and his sayings are his messages. His every gesture, his every move, his every stillness says. He walked the earth, he said, walk the path of Satya. He smiled at us, he said, always be happy. He looked at humanity, he said, see always good. He patted us, fed the needy, and said, love all, serve all. He blessed mankind and said, always be mine. He said it all when he said nothing at all. And now, when Sai is stilled, he still says, still your mind and see myself in everyone. Brothers and sisters, We all are so very specially blessed as we have heard Sai saying, we have seen Sai saying, and we can feel Sai saying. His sayings are his messages, his commands, which must be very breath of all of us that we inhale to assimilate and exhale to act on. Sai descended in Kali age, spread his divinity, touched the hearts with his ever-encompassing love, handpicked a few, drenched them in his effulgence, guarded them, guided them, transformed their beings, and called them their his devotees, his only property, his instruments to spread his message. We all are those chosen ones on whom Swami has placed his trust. Swami has constantly worked on us. And that time we were still. And now when Swami is stilled, it is our turn to incessantly work for him. To be aware that our lives are already custom made for his vision and act on his commands. There was only one Moses whom God handpicked to save his children. Moses heard God's voice from an orange effulgent cloud of flame. We all have seen that effulgence walking the earth. We have seen him taking form clad in saffron hue. Moses found his God on the mount named Sinai. We all live in Sinai-ness, Nai-ness, meaning nearness. Just like Moses received 10 commandments on Mount Sinai, in Sinai-ness, we also have seen and heard our Sai giving his commandments, commands meant to acquire Sinai-ness. So here I am today, with an attempt to garner 10 commandments of Sai from 10 years of my stay in Sinai-ness. 10 years ago, when I was just completing my 12th standard, in this very veranda, my father prayed to Swami, "Swami, bitiya ka kya? What about my daughter?" Swami very lovingly patted him and said it loud, "Idhar deta. Shall give here," and thereafter he kept on giving me, and he gave me everything. He gave me an admission into his university. He gave me an admission into his heart, and he added mission to my life. But more than anything, he gave me his nearness, and Sai nearness brought newness to my life. And then I grew up with Sai Sankalpa, Sai in Sai Sannidhi, to undertake Sai Samskaranam. And these were the first three commandments of Sai. My first three steps, my kindergarten education in Sai Educare, the first three S's, Sai Sankalpa, Sai Sannidhi, and Sai Samskaranam. Sai Sankalpa, the very first speaker talked about the divine will. Yes, for all of us, his students, Sai Sankalpa, divine will is the very first step in his Sai Educare. He willed Idhar Deta and it happened. So I learned Sai Sankalpa is must be my life. With Sai Sankalpa, naturally flows Sai Sannidhi. Before coming here, God was something very remote and a universal concept for me. But now, God has become somebody my very own. Somebody whom I know who is continuously thinking about me, whom I am continuously thinking about, and that is to stay continuously in Sai Sannidhi. In Sai Sannidhi, we don't feel any dependence on material world or world around. In Sai Sannidhi becomes our solitude. It becomes our company. Sai Sannidhi brings to us a very new world in which only we are there with our own God. And when there is Sai, Sannidhi naturally comes in a transformation, that is Sai Samskaranam, my third lesson. In his discourse delivered on 15th June 1989, Swami has emphasized on the importance of the process of samskara, which is to bring refinement in life. He says, even an object needs refinement before it can be used by a man. He gives an example of paddy, which can be consumed by man only when transformed into rice. And then he goes on to say, if object needs to acquire the higher value, needs to undergo this process of refinement, then how much of transformation does man, who is much more important than object, needs? Yes, this was my next lesson. Inner transformation is very important, and it can become naturally our way if we are open to it. In fact, in Sai Sannidhi, we unawares live in Sai culture, Sai discipline, and Sai value. And with this, Sai Samskaranam becomes very easy and natural process to us. With these three S's, as our ABC base for Sai Educare, I move on to the high school commandments. The next three S's, Sai Sakhyam, Sai Saukhyam, and Sai Sneham. At this level of education, children feel the need for a true friendship, true well-being, and true love. Sai Sakhyam, who is our true friend? One, who takes care of our spiritual well-being, who helps us to attain higher goals, and one who frees our mind of all its dilemmas. At this stage of my growth, I watched my mind becoming more inquisitive, challenging and testing God's presence in my life. Once, my curiosity led me to question the blue color of sky. And I went to my friends, my teachers, and asked them why the sky was blue in color. Well, they did give me some answers, but nothing really satisfied my soul. After a few days, all of us from Anandpur came to Parthi. It was on 27th of September 2009 that Swami decided to bless all of us with a discourse. And he opened the discourse by glorifying his creation, and he went on explaining the blue color of sky. He said, the oceans and the sky then became blue. The blue color is the indicative of the vastness of ocean and sky. Then he said, God is also vast. Thus, God is portrayed in blue in his appearance. And that was the answer that really satisfied me. That's my true Sakha, taking care of the most silly of my dilemmas. Well, from this incident, I understood that he is my only friend. I also understood why he is my only friend. He not only answered my dilemmas, which were mundane and worldly, but also gave me the spiritual edge of every experience, every incident, my reactions, my problems. He gave me deeper insights into life, and that is Sai Saukhyam. My next lesson was that Sai is my only spiritual master. It is very essential in life to train our minds towards discerning spiritual and philosophical meaning of every moment that we live. I understood that every moment is his experience. In every difficulty lies our growth. Every uncertainty and delay is his way. In every pain and pleasure is our growth. And then I understood to drop the past, live the present, and surrender the future. Just yesterday in Swami's discourse, Swami said, see divine in every being. And that's precisely what spirituality itself says. It says spirit plus actuality. Actualizing our own spirit. Spirituality is in experiencing, feeling that true spirit, true essence, not only in our own selves, but in every object, every experience and every incident. And there lies the true spirituality. And that's what Sai Saukhyam leads all of us to. Now, this way of spirituality becomes easily attainable when we have the miraculous Sai Sneham. Yesterday, in the introductory talk, Sir said, the core of our Sai institutions is Sai Sneham, Sai love. He said, it is love that heals, love that transforms, and love that inspires. It's so true. Why do we really think that we get consoled when Swami consoles us? Why do we think that we get guided and attracted towards Swami's missions and his inspirations? It is only because he truly loves us. And that was my next lesson. Sai Sneham is the sole force behind Sai Samskaranam. While Swami's creating vibhuti, chain, statues, rings are no doubt his miracles, but the greatest of the miracle that the earth has ever seen is Sai Sneham, love, which is same to each one of us, equally unconditional, so pure, so true, unsullied and divine. That is the miracle of Kali Age. It is the miracle of his love that touches our heart and we transform. It is the miracle of his love that many of us who are sitting here without having seen Swami, without having heard him, without having his physical darshan, still believe in his godhood and willingly adopt to Sai's way. In fact, the earth won't have ever seen the irony that filled the air of 24th of April 2011. While devotees from all around the world were rushing into Parthi to just have Swami's last physical darshans, here was our Swami who was incessantly taking care of food, water, comfort, lodging and security of the same devotees. That is Sai Sneham. Kali Age would have seen the pure love, pure the willing hearts just sharing love for their Sai on that particular day. And that is the power of Sai Sneham. Sai Sneham is so enticing that inner transformation, Sai Samskaranam, just happens, becomes a willing process. When inner transformation naturally becomes our choice, then we lead to the next higher grade in Sai Educare, and that is next three S's, Sai Shwasam, Sai Sevanam, and Sai Samarpanam. Sai Shwas, that divine breath is present in every being. In fact, every breath taken as an offering to Sai becomes Sai Namasmaranam in itself, as every breath is Sai Shwas. Now, how to really fill our hearts with this Sai Shwas? Swami gives a beautiful analogy. He says, to empty a pail filled with dirty water, open the tap of pure water into it. As the pure water fills in, dirty water will flow out. So, in order to purify our heart, we just need to fill it with pure love, and naturally, all shud ripples will be cleansed from our heart. That we all are already chosen by Swami as his devotees, this process of purification has already begun. His Sai loves is incessantly flowing into our hearts. Now it depends on us how soon we empty our pails. After this comes Sai Sevanam. Swami says, love all, serve all. In fact, loving somebody truly is service in itself, and that is Sai Sevanam. Sai Sevanam doesn't ask anything from us. It needs a ready and a willing heart and ready hands. Our readiness to give our lives in his service is much more important than the measure of work that we do. In fact, just the speaker before me I think the first speaker said that Swami himself said he doesn't want us to want anything from us but to please him. That is Sai service, Sai seva. We just need to make ourselves available for his work. Now the question is, what is his work and what is our work? In one of the interviews, Swami told my father, Bahut kaam karta, bahut kaam karta, you work so hard. To this, my father replied, aap hi ka kaam hai Swami, aap hi karte, main kuch nahi karta. All is your work and you alone do it, I do nothing. Swami laughed with compassion and said with a commanding voice, yes, your work is my work. And that was my next lesson. Swami's work is our work offered to him with pure heart. Now, Sai Shwasam can be felt within. Sai Sevanam can be offered only when we are ready to completely surrender ourselves. While Sai Shwasam is a surrender of our hearts, Sai Sevanam is surrender of our hands, Sai Samarpanam is surrender of our mind. I realized all my doubts, my challenge, my testing Swamis, I can just overcome all this only when I surrender my mind. I also realized surrendering the mind is not a very easy job. But then Swami taught me how to do it so easily. He whispered to me to avoid 6 W's and 1 H, all the interrogatives of English, which, where, why, what, who, whose, and how. If we avoid that, we surrender ourselves. In fact, when we use all these interrogatives in English sentence, the sentence becomes complex sentence. And when we use all these interrogatives in our lives also becomes complex life. And when we entertain such doubts, we question Sai Sankalpa. Praying to Swami to help me completely surrender to his will, I now move on to the highest kind of learning in Sai Educare. Just yesterday in Swami's discourse, Swami asserted Sai is the only truth. And that is the last and the 10th commandment of Sai Educare. The only S, Sai Satyam. Sai is the only truth and everything else is his mere image. I understood, Swami taught me that it is not we who speak, it is not we who think, it is not we who act. It is he who is the word, it is he who is the thought and the deed. We are mere puppets in his hand. And our every stillness, our every move depends on the string that he is holding. Now the question arises, if everything has to be his will, then where is our efforts? Our efforts lies in accepting Sai Sankalpa as our ultimate will. In constantly trying to be in Sai Sannidhi and to be open to Sai Samskaranam. Our efforts lies in developing attachment only to God for Sai Sakhyam, Sai Saukhyam and Sai Sneham. Our endeavor must be to turn inward and feel the flow of Sai Shwasam within and make Sai Sevanam our way of life. But our rigorous effort must be in surrendering ourselves in Sai Samarpanam. And what is our ultimate effort? To realize that ultimate Satyam in Sai Satyam. Now these 10 commandments are just a speck in the vast ocean of Swami's teachings. While this 10S can become our way of life if we have 3 yet ultimate S's as the center of our life, that is Sri Satya Sai. If he is the center of life, all the S's will just follow. Just yesterday, Swami said in his discourse that while we have theoretical knowledge of everything, we fail to practice. So here, I stand humbled, praying to Swami, please bestow wisdom on me to live your commandments. Moses was handpicked to show the children of God the promised land. All of us are chosen ones as the torchbearers of Sinai mission to show the children of Sinai their promised land, this miraculous world of Sinai. And what is required from us is our sensitivity towards Sinai's saying, his commandments and his messages. So let us all see him say, hear him say, and feel him says. Let us make Sinai's saying our asset, our only property, our purpose and our life. I conclude my talk with a short prayer to Sinai. O Sinai, make me live your commands. Absorb your sayings and spread your message. Keep me ever in Sinai-ness, always garnering command after command, making my life worthy of all that you give me, offering it to thee as thine. Sairam.
On the behalf of everyone present here, I take the opportunity to profusely thank all the three speakers for sharing their valuable thoughts, insights, and experiences with all of us. I now humbly pray to Bhagwan to bless us all with his divine benedictory message. Bhagwan's divine message will be followed by a musical offering dedicated at his lotus feet, rendered by the students of the Brindavan campus, Sri Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning. Jai Sai Ram.
Astiram Jivanam Loke Astiram Yavanam Dhanam Astiram Dhara पुत्रादि धर्मं प्रेमं द्वयं स्थिरं अस्थिरं जीवनं लोके प्रेम स्वरूपलारा
embodiments of love.
ఈ ప్రపంచమునందు ఏది కూడాను శాశ్వతమైనది లేదు.
In this world, there's nothing that is permanent.
అన్నియు కదలిపోవునటువంటి మేఘములే.
All are like passing clouds.
జీవితము కాని వస్తు మహారాజులు కాని సంపదలు కాని బంధుత్వం కాని సర్వము కూడాను కాలానుగుణ్యంగా కలిగిపోవునటువంటివి.
Either life, material objects, comforts and conveniences, the wealth and all relations, they are bound to pass off, vanish with the march of time.
మానవ జీవితము చాలా విలువైనటువంటిది.
Human life is highly valuable.
జీవించదగినటువంటిది.
It has to be lived well.
ఇట్టి మానవ జీవితమునందు ఇంద్రియ సమేతంగా దేహమును ధరించి పంచభూతముల చేత మానవుడు ప్రయాణము సరుపుతున్నాడు ఈ జగత్తులందు.
Man carries on his life sojourn, gifted with the senses and the body, interacting with the five senses around.
ఇది మనస్సునకు ప్రత్యేకించినటువంటిది కాదు.
It is not anything separate for the mind.
మనసునకు దేహము ఒక కవచం వంటిది.
For the mind, body is an armor.
ప్రతి ప్రాణికి ప్రతి జీవికి ఈ దేహములు ఒక కవచం వంటివిగా ధరిస్తూ ఉంటున్నాయి.
every living creature, every living being has this body as an armor, protecting shield.
Aina patigini itti dharinchinatvanti yokka manavattamunu sadviniyoga parichi sadaacharamlandu praveshapetti tadwara manasunaku shantini cheekurchali.
Having been given this body, we have to take to good practices, good behavior, and see that the body enjoys the peace.
Kani manavudu dehamulo bandhipabadinatundi ee manasu ani chintinchadam cheta taanu oka bandudaipothunnadu.
Man has enslaved himself by the misnomer that his mind is imprisoned within the body.
దేహములో బంధింపబడినటువంటిది కాదు ఈ మనసు.
ఇన్ ఫ్యాక్ట్ మైండ్ ఇస్ నాట్ ఇంప్రిజన్డ్ ఇన్ ద బాడీ.
ఇది బంధింపబడినది తలుచుకోవటం ఇది ఒక పెద్ద అజ్ఞానం.
టు ఫీల్ దట్ ఇట్ ఇస్ బౌండ్ ఇస్ ఎ సైన్ ఆఫ్ ఇగ్నోరెన్స్.
మనోమూలం విధం జగత్తు సర్వత్రా వ్యాపించుతూనే ఉన్నది ఈ మనసు.
మైండ్ ఇస్ ఆల్ పర్వేసివ్.
దేనికి ఇది బంధన కాదు.
It cannot be bound by anyone.
అది ఎప్పుడూ కూడాను స్వతంత్రంగానే ఉంటుంది.
It always remains free.
కాని దేహము దీనికి ఒక పనిముట్టు వంటిది.
But the body, however, is an instrument.
అయితే ఈ పనిముట్టును కూడాను మనం సక్రమమైన రీతిలో సరైన మార్గములో అనుభవించడానికి కృషి చేయాలి.
The instrument has got to be used in the right direction and in a proper way.
పంచకూతముతో కూడినటువంటి ఒక ఈ శరీరము నేనే అని భ్రమించి తన యొక్క తత్వాన్ని జీవతత్వంగా మార్చుకునలేక దైవత్వంగా మార్చుకునలేక కేవలము పంచభౌతికమైన దేహంగానే విశ్వసిస్తున్నాడు మానవుడు.
మ్యాన్ కన్సిడర్స్ దట్ ఈస్ జస్ట్ ద బాడీ, ఐడెంటిఫైయింగ్ హింసెల్ఫ్ విత్ ది ఫైవ్ ఎలిమెంట్స్ విత్ విచ్ ద బాడీ హస్ బీన్ కంపోజ్డ్. But he doesn't know his true nature nor the divine principle behind it.
ఈ విశాల ప్రపంచమనందు ప్రతి మానవుడు కూడాను ఈ శరీరమును నేను 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 అనేటువంటి పదముతో వినియోగిస్తుంటున్నాడు.
In this vast world, everyone identifies himself with the body and calls I and I.
కానీ దేహము తాను కాదు.
You are not the body.
దేహము కేవలం కవచం వంటిది అని చెప్పారు.
Bhagavan said that body is just an armor.
ఇది ధరించినటువంటి ఒక పనిముట్టు.
It is a vesture that you put on which is better than an instrument.
నేను భావించుకోవటమే పెద్ద అజ్ఞానము.
To identify yourself the body is sign of ignorance.
విలువలేని ఇనుప పెట్టెయందు విలువ కలిగిన నగను చేర్చినట్టు.
It is something like costly jewels kept in an iron safe that has no value.
ఈ విలువలేని దేహమునందు విలువైనటువంటి సద్గుణములు దాచిపెట్టుకున్నాం మనం.
మోస్ట్ వాల్యుబుల్ వర్చ్యూస్ ఆర్ ప్రెసెంట్ ఇన్ ది ఐరన్ సేఫ్ దట్ హస్ నో వాల్యూ.
ఈ దేహము పరిశుద్ధమైనటువంటిది కాదు.
ద బాడీ ఇస్ నాట్ దట్ ప్యూర్.
ఇది మలినపు కొంప.
ఇస్ వన్ ఆఫ్ డర్ట్.
రోగముల బ్రగ్గెడు సేవక గంప.
ఫుల్ ఆఫ్ అఫ్లిక్షన్స్.
జాత సంచలనము పొందుతుంప.
ఇట్ పెరినేట్స్ లైఫ్ ఆఫ్టర్
మొగ సాగరమే దిగలేని కంప.
కెనాట్ క్రాస్ దిస్ ఓషన్.
అమ్ముల పదిలంబు మన మెప్పు దలంప.
ఫుల్ ఆఫ్ బోన్స్.
నేను స్థిరమని నమ్మబోకు మనస.
ఓ మై నెవర్ థింక్ దట్ ఇట్ ఇస్ పర్మనెంట్.
ఈ దేహమునే నీవు సత్యంగా భావించి ఈ దేహ నిమిత్తమై నీవు అనేక విధమైనటువంటి పాటు పడుతున్నావు.
You consider this body is true and permanent and struggle hard to keep it.
దేహమే నేను భావించటం చేతనే మానవుడు అనేక కష్టముల గురి అవుతున్నాడు.
Man is facing all troubles and difficulties because of this body.
దేహమును కాపాడుకునే నిమిత్తము దేశమును పోషించుకునే నిమిత్తము దేహమును భద్రం చేసుకునే నిమిత్తము అన్ని రకమైనటువంటి బాధలు అనుభవిస్తున్నాడు.
Man is passing through all kinds of difficulties only to maintain, protect and sustain the body.
Kani indulo satya sankalpalanu chakkaga artham chesukovali.
But one has to understand the principle of truth within.
Satya sankalpamle manavuniki sariyina aasti.
And truthful thoughts constitute your property.
Atti pavitramaina satya sankalpalanu vismarinchi
we forget that sacred thoughts truth.
Kevalam bahyamainatundi అనిత్యమైనటువంటి అశాశ్వతమైనటువంటి ప్రాకృతమైనటువంటి సంస్కారమును పుంజుకొని
వి గో బై దిస్ టెంపరరీ ఎక్స్టర్నల్ ఫ్యామిలీ.
ఈ సంస్కారం చేతనే కర్మలు ఆవిర్భవిస్తున్నాయి.
అండ్ అవుట్ ఆఫ్ దిస్ వి స్టార్ట్ రిజార్టింగ్ టు యాక్షన్.
కర్మల వల్లనే అభిమానం అభివృద్ధి అవుతున్నది.
Actions lead us to attachment.
ఈ అభిమానం అభివృద్ధి కావడం చేతనే
as attachment rises
మానవత్వాన్ని శీలమును కోల్పోతుందని
the human being loses the character.
ఈ శీలమును కోల్పోవడం చేతనే
as the character is lost
తన దివ్యత్వము తాను మర్చిపోతున్నాడు.
He is forgetting his own innate divinity.
కానీ శీలం అన్నటువంటిది చాలా గొప్ప విలువైనటువంటిది.
Character is the biggest value.
ఒకానొక సమయం లోపల ఇంద్రుడు తన రాజ్యమును కోల్పోయి బృహస్పతి అయినటువంటి యొక్క దేవఋషి దగ్గరికి వచ్చాడు.
At one time Indra lost his kingdom and he approached the preceptor Brihaspati.
Swami,
నేను
రాజ్య భ్రష్టుడయ్యాను.
I lost my kingdom, Swami.
తిరిగి రాజ్యాన్ని పొందేటువంటి అవకాశం నాకు లభించునా?
Will I be able to get back the kingdom anytime?
ఏ విధమైన మార్గం అనుసరించినప్పుడు ఇది నాకు ప్రాప్తిస్తుంది అని ప్రశ్నించాడు.
Which procedure will help me to get back my kingdom?
అప్పుడు బృహస్పతి చెప్పాడు.
Then Brihaspati told.
ఆయన ఇప్పుడు ప్రహ్లాదుడు విశ్వజిత్ అనేటువంటి యజ్ఞం గావిస్తున్నాడు.
This is the time when Prahlada is performing a yajna by name.
ఈ అడిగిన వారికందరికీ అందించేటువంటి ఒక దానమును తాను సిద్ధం చేసుకున్నాడు.
He has got all objects to offer in charity to those that attend.
ఇప్పుడు నీవు ఇంద్రుని వలె నీవు వెళ్ళకూడదు.
You don't go this in this form of Indra.
పేద బ్రాహ్మణుడి వలె వేషం వేసుకొని
have the dress of a poor brahmin.
ఆ ప్రహ్లాదుని దగ్గరికి వెళ్ళి
you go to Prahlada
bichhamu prarthinchu
and ask for alms.
Sari,
he accepted.
Brihaspati cheppinattuga brahmana veshamu dharinchadu vellaadu.
Indra has taken upon himself the role of a poor brahmin and approached
Prahlada. Andariki adigina vaadikanta kudanu daanam nandistunnadu.
And Prahlada was giving what all that is sought for.
Ee indrudu పేద బ్రాహ్మణుని వేషం వేసుకున్నటువంటి ఇంద్రుడు దగ్గరికి వెళ్ళాడు.
And this poor brahmin has approached.
నాకు ఏం కావాలి అని ప్రహ్లాదుడు ప్రశ్నించాడు.
ప్రహ్లాద asked, what do you want?
ప్రహ్లాద, నాకు నీ శీలం కావాలి అన్నాడు.
The poor brahmin asked Prahlada, I want your character.
ప్రహ్లాద చిరునవ్వు నవ్వి,
ప్రహ్లాద smiled,
నా శీలం తీసుకుని నీవేం ప్రయోజనము?
What is that you do with my character?
ఈ జగత్తునందు అనేక రకమైనటువంటి సమస్యలు ఉంటున్నాయి.
In this world there are many problems.
అనేక విధమైనటువంటి బాధలు ఉంటున్నాయి.
There's so much of suffering.
ఇలాంటి వాటిని పరిహారం గావించుకునే నిమిత్తమై కోరవలసిన కోరికోకు.
In fact you ask for the solution to the problems.
నాకు ఏది అక్కర్లేదు.
The poor brahmin said, I don't want any.
కానీ నీ శీలమును మాత్రం నాకు దానం చేయమన్నాడు.
I want you to offer me your character.
సరే, పేద బ్రాహ్మణు యొక్క మనసును సంతృప్తి పరచడము తన యొక్క లక్ష్యం.
ప్రహ్లాద thought that his duty to satisfy this poor brahmin.
ఇదిగో బ్రాహ్మణ, నా శీలం నీకు ఇస్తున్నాను అన్నాడు.
He said, brahmin, I am giving you my character.
తక్షణమే దివ్యమైనటువంటి తేజస్సుతో ప్రహ్లాదు నుండి ఒక పురుషుడు బయలుదేరాడు.
Out of Prahlada came out a self-effulgent divine form.
బయలుదేరినటువంటి యొక్క ఈ తేజస్సు కలిగినటువంటి పురుషుడు ఆ యొక్క పేద బ్రాహ్మణులో ప్రవేశించాడు.
This divine form that came out of Prahlada has got into the brahmin.
ఆ ప్రవేశించిన ప్రహ్లాదుడు ప్రశ్నించాడు, ఎవరు మీరు? నా నుండి ఆవిర్భవించి ఆ యొక్క వ్యక్తిలో మీరు ప్రవేశిస్తున్నారు, మీ పేరేమిటి అని అడిగాడు.
As his divine self-effulgent form started leaving Prahlada, Prahlada asked, who are you? Why are you going?
అప్పుడు చెప్పాడు,
Then he said,
నేను నీ శీలమును,
I am your character.
నీవి బ్రాహ్మణుకు దానం ఇచ్చావు.
You offered me to that poor brahmin.
కొడుని నేను ఇతన్ని ప్రవేశిస్తున్నాను అన్నాడు.
So I am getting into him.
సరే పొమ్మన్నాడు ప్రహ్లాదుడు.
And Prahlada permitted.
మరి కొంతసేపటికి మరో తేజస్ స్వరూపుడైనటువంటి పురుషుడు ఆవిర్భవించాడు.
Later another brilliant form came out of Prahlada.
అతన్ని చూచాడు ప్రహ్లాదుడు.
Prahlada stared.
నీవెవరు?
Who are you?
నేను ఈ యొక్క శీలము యొక్క సర్వెంట్ను.
I am the servant of the character.
ఆ శీలము నీదో లేనప్పుడు నేను ఈ సైన్యాధిపతిగా ఇక్కడ ఉండి నేను ప్రయోజనం ఉండదు. కనుకనే శీలం చోతనే నేను కూడా చేరి సైన్యాధిపతిగా అక్కడ అతన్ని సంరక్షిస్తానన్నాడు.
Without that character, I cannot be there as the chief of the army as the chief, I am also leaving, following his character.
సరే వెళ్ళమన్నాడు.
And Prahlad affirmed.
మరి కొన్ని నిమిషం చూసేటప్పటికి,
after some time,
ఒక సుందరమైన స్త్రీ అతని నుండి ఆవిర్భవించింది.
A beautiful feminine form came out of him.
ఆమె కొడుము తిరిగి ఆ పేద బ్రాహ్మణులో ప్రవేశించడానికి పోతుండాలి.
And that feminine form started getting into the poor Brahmin.
అమ్మ, మీరెవరు అని ప్రశ్నించాడు.
Prahlad asked, mother, who are you?
అప్పుడు ఆమె చెప్పింది.
She replied,
ప్రహ్లాద, నేను రాజ్యలక్ష్మిని.
I am the wealth of your kingdom.
క్యారెక్టర్ లేనప్పుడు, అనగా శీలము లేనప్పుడు,
when there is no character,
సైన్యాధిపతి లేనప్పుడు,
when there is no army
chief, నా రక్షణ జరగదు.
I can't be protected.
కనుక నేను కూడా వారితో వెళుతున్నానని.
So I am also following them.
అప్పుడు ప్రహ్లాదుడు చింతించాడు.
Then Prahlad thought over.
శీలం అంటే ఎంత విలువైనటువంటిది.
Character is so valuable.
ఆ శీలము లేనప్పుడు రాజ్యభ్రష్టుడు కూడా అవుతుంటాడు.
As he lost the character, he is losing the kingdom too.
రాజ్యాన్ని కాపాడేటువంటి సైన్యాధిపతి కూడాను తన వశము తప్పించుకుంటాడు.
And the chief of the army also leaves his place.
కనుక శీలమే చాలా ప్రధానమైనటువంటిదని ఆనాటి నుండి ప్రహ్లాదుడు తన రాజ్యంలో చాటుతూ వచ్చాడు.
Since then, Prahlada started publicizing the fact that character is most important.
ఈ యొక్క యువకులైనటువంటి విద్యార్థులు,
students, youngsters,
astiram janam lokam,
they should understand this world is
astiram yavanam dharam,
the youth and money are temporary,
astiram dhara putradilu,
the family, the wife and children are temporary.
Ee yavanam dharam anetundi enta varaku untundi?
Youth and wealth, how long they last?
Dhanamu kadilipoyeetundi megamulu vantidi.
The wealth is like passing cloud.
Vyangava yavanam anetundi oka minchu minchettuga oka chalamulo idi చాలా మార్పు కలుగుతుంది.
సో ఆల్సో యూ దట్ వానిషెస్ లైక్ లైట్నింగ్, లైక్ ఫ్లాష్.
అయినప్పటికీ నీ గుణమును నీవు కాపాడుకో.
సేఫ్ గార్డ్ యువర్ ఓన్ క్యారెక్టర్.
అది నీ యొక్క ప్రధాన లక్ష్యము.
దట్ షుడ్ బి యువర్ చీఫ్ ఎయిమ్
అని ఈ ప్రహ్లాదుని యొక్క తత్వమును బోధించాడు ఆ యొక్క సమావేశంలో.
అండ్ దిస్ వాస్ ద మెసేజ్ ఆఫ్ ప్రహ్లాద టాక్ టు ది అసెంబ్లీ.
కనుక ప్రతి మానవుడు కూడాను మొట్టమొదట తన ప్రవర్తన చక్కగా ఉంటుండాలి.
Therefore every man should see that his character will be perfect.
ప్రవర్తనే సల్లేకుండా మానవత్వమే మరుగైపోతుంది.
Otherwise the human value is gone, humanness vanishes.
Beloved Swami, we, your students from the Sri Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning, Vrindavan campus, offer at your lotus feet a bouquet of devotional songs. Music is the reflection of the longing of the soul. It gives form to the pure and unsullied love that surges forth to the Almighty and manifests itself as an expression of devotion that is latent within every heart. No wonder is music the greatest way to pour out one's innermost feelings and move the Lord. And when the Lord responds, there is no greater joy for the devotee. Swami, when you walk towards us and stand by our side, the moment seems like eternity. Your glance soothes the heated mind. Your sweet words uplifts the gloomy heart. And your simple gesture dispels the veil of illusion. Let our minds eternally contemplate on Thee. Let our lives be sanctified by being a part of thy divine drama. This is the feeling captured in our first song, Neenu Balige Bandu Nilalu. सुधेय सिंचना निन्न मधुर माति निंदा नंद मन के सांत्वना नीनु सन्ने माड़े सागु माए दूर सरीवणु नीनु अभय माते बनी बड़ो तीनो बड़ी गे बंधु निलदो भव्य भाव बंधुरा मोड़ी भरुआ हृदय दल्ले पूर्ण शरद चंदिरा तीनो बड़ी गे बंधुरा हगलु इरुलु बिडरेरली मनदि निन्न चिंतना अंतरंग दाळदल्ली नडे हृदय मंथना त्याग योग प्रेम मूर्ति भव्य दिव्य चेतना निन्न रंग लीले यम्म जन्म पावना As a child yearns for its mother, Swami, we yearn for you. But unique indeed is the relationship where the Lord experiences the love of His physical mother. Be it little Satya experiencing Mother Ishwaramma's love, or the naughty little Krishna seeking Mother Yashoda's lap. So charming is this scene where the Lord of Universe
tells his mother that he just has a fistful of butter in exchange for his mother's love, which is like an ocean of milk. Kai niraye venna taram.
Yeah.
Mother is the one supreme force that supports, nurtures, and protects us. Swami says, Mother is the pillar of the home, of society, of the nation, and so of humanity itself. The next song is a prayer to Mother Saraswati, who resides on our tongue and acts through our hands. Ambavani nannu adarinchave.
Sari ga ma pa da ni sa sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa a na 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 no Ambavani nanna adarinchave 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 Ambavani nanna adarinchave
Baba, 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 baba
Moment, our hearts pine for your darshan, Swami. And only the indweller of all hearts can feel the agony in the hearts of all. For it is this darshan of yours that strikes our hearts and evokes the love for you and engulfs us in supreme serenity. Mere man prem lago har teer.
मेरे मन प्रेम लगो हरते मेरे मन प्रेम लगो हरते मेरे मन प्रेम लगो हरते हमरे बेगन हर प्रभ जाने हमरे बेगन हर प्रभ जाने मेरे मन अंतर की मेरे मन प्रेम लगो हरते मेरे मन प्रेम लगो हरते दर्शन को मेरा मन बहुत तपते हर दर्शन को मेरा मन बहुत तपते सारे हर दर्शन को मेरा मन बहुत तपते हर दर्शन को मेरा मन बहुत तपते जो त्रिखबंत बिनरी जो त्रिखबंत बिनरी निरहर प्रीतम की निरहर प्रीतम की कोई बात सुनावे सो पाए सो मिलावे सो पाए सो मिलावे मेरे मन प्रेम लगो प्रेम लगो हरते सखी गुण कहो मेरे प्रभ के प्रभ के गुण कहो मेरे प्रभ के गुण कहो मेरे प्रभ के जन नानक की हर मेरे मन प्रेम लगो मेरे मन प्रेम लगो
song is a composition of Saint Kabir, who declares, "Men are born with a helpless lamenting cry. They must live to die with a smile of eternal joy." The song extols the glory of the Lord as it gently meanders into the melodious Rag Malkons and the powerful Rag Bhairavi, returning to Rag Desh. The devotee rejoices in the bliss of chanting the divine name as the Lord's grace envelops his being like a protective shroud. Chadariya, Jeeni Re, Jeeni.
जब हम पैदा हुए जग हंसे हम रोए ऐसी करनी कर चलो हम हंसे जग रोए चदरिया जीनी रे जीनी जीनी रे जीनी हे राम नाम रसभीनी चदरिया जीनी रे जीनी हे राम नाम रसभीनी चदरिया जीनी रे कमल का चरखा बनाया पांच तत्व की बोली अष्ट कमल का चरखा बनाया पांच तत्व की बोली नौ दस मास बुलन को लागे नौ दस मास बुलन को लागे Oh
रख मैं नहीं पीनी चदरिया जीनी रे जीनी ये राम नाम रस भीनी चदरिया जीनी रे जीनी सुखदेव ने निर्मल कीनी ध्रुव प्रहलाद सुदामा ने ओढ़ी सुखदेव ने निर्मल कीनी ध्रुव प्रहलाद सुदामा
Thank you for this wonderful opportunity. We conclude with a tilana in which the devotee surrenders to the Divine Mother, declaring, "You are the Mother of the universe. Other than you, is there any other refuge in all of the seven worlds?" Unnai sharanadaindhen.
के गौरी नारायणी नमोस्तुते नारायणी नमोस्तुते नारायणी नमोस्तुते
Thank you. समस्त लोका सुखिनो भवन्तु समस्त लोका सुखिनो भवन्तु
शांति शांति शांति।